somewhat of an informal arrangement. Back then, and am I reading this correctly that this is becoming common practice now? Or I'm just kind of, you know, gaining some reassurance on that.
We learned a lot from the reality check visit, which was really useful for us, and for that to be kind of pointed out to us about what we've achieved there has been based on relationships. So we've looked a bit kind of wider, and it's probably no surprise that because it was really well-vetted relationships between health and the early childhood service in Wallasey with the Senior Children's Centre, we're actually can see that the take-up of the integrated reviews better in that area, as is the take-up of two-year-old funding is better in that area, and I think it's the joint approach. So one of the focuses there where we're talking about formalising those into relationships is we've got to replicate that in the other areas through commission arrangements and formalising to get those teams working together as standard on the based on.
So that's an aspiration now?
Yes. Yeah. I'd like to point out that the reality check has helped us as a service to recognise that.
That's good that a lot of feedback from one of our reality check visits. Does anyone have any more questions?
Thanks, Sharon. Just coming back to the improving outcomes with disadvantaged children that you want to focus on moving forward. Obviously, we get 2-year-olds to take up preschool places, and then obviously, in term time, that gives them something there. But what happens in the school holidays? Do you make sure that something happening at all year round with the children that are not left? And now, obviously, Frankfield's been looking at feeding children as well in the school holidays. How does that work for children who aren't in primary school yet, so the younger children? Is there something? I don't know about how it tackles that.
I'm
just wondering how that comes down to the early years.
The early childhood service has a what's on offer that's delivered in each locality through the hubs and spokes. So key times for us are those downtimes in terms of the funded nursery places. So we ensure that our offer during those periods are maximised in terms of sessions for stay and play, for parent-child sessions, for fresh sessions. And we make sure we publicise that well in advance to the different settings so that parents know while they're not able to access the funded places that there's activities going on locally for them.
So is there a good take-up equal to the preschool places?
I couldn't say off the top of my head, but the sustained contact was how we would measure that.
Yeah.
We have increased, I'm not sure if I think we've only put it for target groups into this report, but it's through sustained contact that we would look at the take-up of those.
Thank you. So priority three, the last one, a consultation proposed commenced. Can you tell me how long you think the consultation will take? But I'm really interested in what the parents think really went for them, and if you can have a report back.
That piece of work has been led by the parents in the lead who's employed by Cheshire Rural Partnerships. So she has personally been contacting families and undertaking face-to-face interviews with them. These are people that have attended a range of different groups, some provided by councils, some by voluntary sector, some jointly, and they're doing interviews to find out what works. I think she said it's going to be completed in February, but I can ask for that report to be
Send them.
And then there's an official launch on the 5th of March, which people will be invited to.
Well, it sounds like our reality check limits are so I think they're very useful on that. I'm very much to continue with the role in the reality check project. We made the major report. Are there any recommendations for how we can do the reality checks?
I think I mentioned during the visit here that we should have an opportunity to speak to frontline staff. I know from the previous reality check visits we have, but I think we just pressed the time at this particular one and we didn't have so much of an opportunity. So, yeah, if we can make sure that's definitely back to the day to day of our visits.
I do remember you mentioning, well, I think it was a lack of luck on your part, unfortunately, because we have, you don't have to believe me on this, but we have spoken to staff on all the other visits.
Yeah,
no. It's so difficult.
So we can make that routine part of the reality check. Okay, so item 8 is a summary of standards and visual outcomes for Key Stage 4 and Key Stage 5. We have 2018.
Okay, so I gave you quite a comprehensive report here, probably the most comprehensive that we've had in previous years. There is a note of caution, and I did put it in at the beginning of the report, and that's the huge changes in the GCSE and the GCSE programs. So it's something that we just need to keep an eye on. The reason I did the analysis slightly differently this time was to look at the available data on the DfE website to look at how our non-selective schools in several areas compare with the national, and also how our grammar schools. And that was to provide additional challenge to our grammar schools because we are a local authority that on the headlines, and I just checked on the BBC website today because the GCSE outcomes have been published. The headlines are disadvantaged children making the grade, and that's the same for us. Our gap is narrowed. Our attainment rate and progress rate, we're in the top 30% nationally, and we're the second highest in the Northwest. So the headlines make you feel really proud to be a rural resident and working on rural. When you unpick it, you can see from the information that I've given you that we do have areas that we're still working on. And there's probably no surprises really that boys are still an issue. So we start off at the age of 4, where we have a gap. And normally in a number of local authorities, you get to GCSE, you get to A-level, and the tide turns. For us, we'll see the A-level results, we've still got girls up and boys. So there's a significant work. And when you look at the grammar schools, boys' grammar schools, you'll see their progress 8 scores. And not where we need to be. So we are trying to put a considerable amount of challenge in there. The other thing that was mentioned today as well was in terms of schools below the floor standard. And we have 3 schools that are below the floor standard this year. Birkenhead Park School, Kingsbury, Mosslands. And so again, it's 2 of our schools in our most deprived areas. Particularly the high percentage of boys are not where they need to be. And when I looked at the progress 8 scores and looked at them, boys versus girls, the girls scores are doing better than boys. Another good news story, which is kind of hot off the press, is that I said to you before that our white British preschool male boys are our key focus within rural. We have one school that appears a trend and has got the best progress 8 score for preschool male white British boys, and that's one of our non-selective comprehensive schools. That's St John Passington. So we've got some really positives, but we've also got some areas of work. And the way that I've presented the report this time, I hope it shows that we are providing challenge to all our secondary schools. In terms of the A levels, We just didn't know what the A-level outcomes were going to be this year, and that's because we're in the process of some of them have been reformed, and if they're reformed, it's like A-levels I did when I was in school, where you did a two-year course and you had three three-hour exams at the end of it, and you never quite knew how you were going to do. So some of those subjects have happened now, and we've done very well actually. And then there's another tranche of A-levels that will become reformed. So again, it'll go from where children would be used to do the ASAs, and then they would be able to retake the modules. That is going. So it's had a repercussion for our students, our teachers getting used to teaching that way, because a lot of our young teachers have never been taught in the old-fashioned way, I would say. So they've been on a huge learning curve. And also the destinations for our students as well, you know, the entry requirements. Each institution has looked differently, whether it's higher education colleges or whether it's universities, because we really didn't know what the outcomes would be. What I've hoped to bring to the future meeting is the destinations of our students and the engineering team.
Yeah, just one question through you, Chair, thank you. Top of page 28, no comparative data with statistical neighbours. As and when that becomes available, can we have that data, please? Yeah.
We've got it today, so I can send something out to you.
Thank you.
So it's always really interesting to read all the data, you know, that data. As a primary school governor, I don't usually scrutinise these particular results. I was just looking for Emily Morgan Academy on the list. So yeah. You just put them in a separate category?
We do, because the nature of the children there is they have a restricted amount of GCSEs that they can do, but I can provide you with that information.
I digress, which I normally do anyway. I was just wondering if we were talking before about the number of exclusions that have been going on in the world lately.
I can. I'll do it briefly, but if the committee would like to come with a report next time, I can do a more detailed analysis for them. I'll do that.
Yeah.
You'll be aware that nationally, exclusions in secondary schools have increased dramatically over the last 2 to 3 years. We have seen an increase in rural, and we've decided that we have a very proactive response to it. So where a school has permanently excluded 3 children in the autumn term, the head teacher has been invited to come and speak to the director and myself in terms of what led to those exclusions, what lessons could we learn, could early help offers could be background of family to support them. This, in the autumn term last year, we had 29 exclusions in the autumn term. This autumn term, we've had 21. So I would like to take credit for the work Reggie and Challenge, but you never can tell because they're different groups of children. I'm quite happy if you want to do that, and I'm fingers crossed that we're seeing a decrease in terms of the challenge. The other thing that the school, secondary schools will be focused on is something called off-rolling. You might have heard that in the news. And the inspection dashboards for each school identify the number of children that have been that have gone off-roll. And so again, the director has written to the schools where there has been evidence of pupils leaving either in year 9, year 10 and year 11 and ask for a case study on each individual. So we have got some responses that come in. If I say to you the highest amount we've got in one school is 33. And the second highest is 24, and we've only got 7 schools that the director's written to, the rest don't have those issues. So again, we're trying to tackle this from a number of questions and not just kind of ticking people off, but basically saying, what can we all do collectively? These are our children, and if they're out of school or they're permanently excluded, particularly if they get excluded in year 11, then their life chances are considerably diminished.
Can I ask another question?
Mine is in relation to it's in relation to what Chris has asked for and what Sue has said she will bring. But could I be asked for it to be a bit more comprehensive and quite details? And so we not only look at exclusions, but we look at children who are being homeschooled and absenteeism.
Yes.
And break it down into ages and outcomes.
And in terms of exclusions, would you like me to break that down into schools and into pupils?
Really detailed.
So, yeah, like that? Yeah, I can do that.
Yeah. Got
that
one.
Just before we go on to punch down this issue, just got a couple of questions myself. The local authorities taking a proactive approach to ensuring that exclusion to the last resort. But are there any schools that don't buy into that approach, and what can we do to tackle?
What I would say is, as you know, academies are autonomous from the local authority. However, we've got a really good relationship with all our academies, and a number of the conversations Paul has already had are with academies. So everybody, we see it as something that all those schools have got to work collectively. And as soon as you start talking about we've got to do what's in the best interest of rural children, it's very hard to go against that if you're a head teacher saying we're not going to cooperate and engage something like that.
And when a child is going to exclude it, what do we, how do we see assurances that any of arrangement is
I'll put that in my report if you want to for the next meeting.
That would be fine.
Because I think you might want to talk quite a bit on this.
I think so. I think it's of interest to quite a few of us. Paul, you had a question.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Again, a really excellent report, so in terms of the format and the detail, really easy to follow, and it's good to hear that we're not resting on our laurels and hiding behind those really good headline figures, but providing that challenge where it needs to be, mentioning the grammar schools, etc. But being a bit parochial, I've noticed that a lost count really in terms of how often in the report it was mentioned that only Wallasey locality was below.
Yeah.
In terms of what we're doing for that particular area, could you provide us with a bit more?
What I would say there, in terms of the maths results, there was a real anomaly in one of our schools, and that was Weatherhead High School. And that was to do with where they entered the children, because they had to enter the children in the high tier or the low tier paper. And they entered children in the high tier paper, and then they didn't get the marks to get the lowest of the high tier, if that makes sense. So that skewed quite considerably the outcomes in Wallasey. And then the other thing that skewed it was the outcomes in Losslands that weren't expected. So in terms of what we do, we have a school cost and concern process where I go in and challenge the school and monitor progress on a half-term basis, just to ensure things are on track. And then the other element, I suppose, in there is Kingsway, which again, that progress ain't measured, they're not where we would have wanted them to be, so, and that school is closing. So the challenge, we will challenge any school that is under, either below the full target, or the results aren't where they are, irrespective of locality. Because we looked at all the data by locality for Key Stage 1, Key Stage 2, we thought, well, we'll give it a go for secondary. It's a bit skewed because in Wallasey as well as no grammar school, and in all the other schools, other localities, there are. So it's just a word of caution really. But so we deal with schools on an individual basis really.
Well, Alan, next, and then Alan.
Thanks, Chair. Just going into the this gap in disadvantaged children's attainment, specifically rural south and rural west.
Yeah.
Is there an issue there that because they may not have as many different styles of approach
exactly
and they're not going to get as much pupil premium?
Sometimes it's to do with pupil premium and sometimes it's to do with they haven't got as many. So each child might equate to 10%,
yeah,
so the gap looks bigger. But when you present gaps like that, what's happened in West Wales in particular, that their heads are all on it, you know, they kind of say, gosh, when you present it within a locality like that, it looks far worse. And so we're having conversations about individual pupils. So it's just kind of tightening up really.
Yeah. Yeah, really quick question. I mean, you highlighted rightly you challenge the schools, and I think I've asked you this question before. Is that really one of your main sticks? Really, is almost to challenge schools. Why are they not performing as they were? But equally, you talk about St John Pleasanton and Sitmore College did particularly well with A levels. Why do they do well?
One of the things in terms of the A levels, what we have learned from sixth form college is that they're very good on transition. Sometimes children that move within their own school, although they're used to the routines and everything, the standard is so much higher. And what the sixth form college are very good at is a series of transition and program and support that they put in for the young people, and that's what we are saying to schools. Because what we haven't got in the report, which I will get to you when we've got it, is the value added. So what I think that will show is that many grammar schools are value added, it's not there for A levels, whereas it is the sixth form college. So what we do is we match institutions up and say, look, you know, you can do very well in this. There's another school that's really good. And I can give an example of that. I think in your papers, unless you've got it on your computer, you will be able to see it. But there's a coloured chart, and what it does for GCSEs, it highlights. You remember when I came last year, I talked to you about baskets, didn't I? I was going to tell you tonight.
Yeah.
I wasn't basket one.
Yeah.
Basket one, English basket two, isn't that? Basket three is the baccalaureate subjects. And basket four is additional approved qualifications. And what we've done is we've highlighted in each of the baskets which schools are the best. So we're matching schools up to say, right, because what we can find, one of the things Central Pleasanton is really good, and the additional qualifications, they do very, very well. So they're sharing the information with other secondary schools to say, these are the courses we teach, this is how we teach it, and these are the outcomes that we get. So you've got kind of
pale grey,
light grey,
very light grey.
You've got colour happy. But it's the kind of collaboration and sharing of good practice that needs to continue to move forward.
Is that transition from primary to secondary equally as important as it will be from GCSE to GCE?
It is, because there's a report also reported out a couple of years ago called Key Stage 3, the Wasted Years. And one of the things that we have done to look at the challenge, a considerable number of UBS 7s were going back to their primary schools and saying, we're doing everything that we did at primary school. So we have done a number of school reviews voluntarily, where we have primary head teachers, work with secondary head teachers, and look at what's going on in their Key Stage 3. And then the secondary heads going and the English and Maths subject leads, or heads of department, going into the primary schools, because the curriculum's hyped up so much in the primary schools, the secondary schools need to be aware of it and the children to the ground with it.
Any more questions?
Can I ask a question?
Go ahead, Chris.
We're trying to come through the thing to update us on Kingsway. There's a few members who weren't there the other week, so I don't know if you just want to give us a quick update on the world to
okay,
those members who actually missed out, because it was really good.
Okay, so just very briefly, every young person that is still attending Kingsway was given the opportunity to put a modified preference form in to then consider what school we wanted to go from September 2018. They have all been received, and all pupils have been allocated schools. Some parents have decided that instead of their child staying in school till the end of the summer term, that they want to move there sooner. And a number of year 10 parents who had initially thought that what they would do was keep their child in school for year 10, and then the children go by a bus over to Liverpool to one of the Northern Schools Trust schools to do their year 11, they decided that they do not want to do that, and they have moved to their schools before the end of term, which kind of makes sense. Wherever possible, there's been work at Kingsway to ensure that the work that's been delivered matches the courses. And so, for example, in English literature, that they're studying the right books so that when they go to their new school, it's not going to be detrimental. So we have provided as much support as we can in terms of the local authority, and we have brokered meetings between Kingsway and the receiving schools. The children that have moved to their new schools, we've had some very, very positive feedback, and they've settled in very, very well.
Thanks.